Okay, I think I'll get started. Thank you for being here. I'm gonna try not to get emotional. It's too early. So this is a different talk, not quite a research presentation, not quite a lecture that many of you are used to. So today, my name is Scott Larson. I'm a teaching faculty here in the FAMU-FSU College of Engineering. And so I have ADHD, if that's not clear from this title slide. And I want to talk about metacognition or metathinking and how it's allowed me to really exploit my ADHD and how all of you can, whether you have a learning disability or ADHD, it doesn't matter. Knowing yourself is very powerful. And so it starts with metacognition. And so that's what I want to talk to you about today. And I want to start with a little background on ADHD and learning disabilities, give you an idea of how prevalent it is. And then I'm going to kind of walk you through my story a bit. And I want to do that for several reasons, which I'll explain. So let me just explain. I like to talk, so let's just kind of stop there. Okay, so first of all, this is the big statistic that everybody shouts out, and that maybe most of you maybe don't even know, is that 1 in 5 people have a learning difference or attention issue. That's 20%. The problem is that a lot are not diagnosed. A lot don't want anyone to know, but it is definitely prevalent. So I want you to know the difference between learning disabilities and ADHD, how they affect the brain, how they classify, et cetera. So learning disabilities are structural differences in the brain. And they're classified by like the symptom type, like the type of learning, the specific type of learning that they affect. So dyslexia, maybe some of you are familiar with, that's a reading disorder, but you also have things like dyscalculia, which is a math disorder, maybe you're not so familiar with. And there's a lot of different types. So there's no cure for this, right? These are structural differences. There's this nice kind of illustration to kind of, basically just illustrate that difference. I wouldn't take this too literal, but this is going, just kind of comparing an autistic brain and a dyslexic brain. So what this is kind of trying to show is that there's what's these called these mini columns. They're folds in the brain, and they span all the cortical layers of the brain. And so the mini columns in the brain of someone who is on the spectrum have different physical geometry and are interconnected differently than someone with a dyslexic brain. So not as many folds, more longer range connections. So this, it greatly affects how people think. So autistic brains think very much about, very, very narrow analysis, right? When they see a dog, they look at the hair color, they look at the tail, they look at the figure, and they say, okay, that's a golden retriever, right? Someone with a dyslexic brain, they look at a dog, they say, oh, that dog is panting, that dog must be thirsty, right? Maybe that dog would want my sandwich, things like that, right? Looking at more of the big picture, the big story, not so much on the focused details. So obviously the brain affects everything, right? But these are learning disabilities. And legally in the education system, they are treated as disabilities. They're classified as disabilities. There's no cure for them. The best we can do is intervention and accommodation. ADHD, or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, is different. So there is recent evidence in the last decade or so that is showing that there is a structural difference in the brain. Previously, it's kind of been thought that it's strictly been a neurotransmitter issue, and dopamine and norepinephrine, they exist at low levels in the brain. Or they aren't released and transmitted properly. But there is evidence now that there are actual structural differences. Part of it is the frontal lobe is underdeveloped or does not develop until much later in life. But in any case, learning disabilities and ADHD is not something people grow up. So that's an important correlation. There's also these subtypes, inattentive, primarily hyperactive, impulsive. Some people have. So in contrast to learning disabilities, ADHD, we do have medication. It does not cure people with ADHD, but it is another tool that we have at our disposal that those with learning disabilities do not have. But we also, of course, have intervention strategies and accommodations. So because ADHD does not affect a specific learning type, the question is then, okay, well, how does it manifest or what does it actually affect? So it affects attention, control, working memory, cognitive flexibility. It greatly affects my cognitive flexibility. So what does that mean? It means when I'm in bed, I don't want to leave bed,
right?
It means when I'm up late and I'm working, I don't want to go to bed. It means I can't switch subjects. I can't think about next week because I'm thinking about what I'm trying to do right now. My wife hates it. So my wife has anxiety. And so it's the exact opposite. I love to be spontaneous. I love to go in without a plan. I like to make it up as I go. My wife needs the plan. She needs to know what we're doing, when we're doing it, what it's going to look like, and she needs to know a year in advance. So our marriage is successful. That's what I'll say. So speaking of planning, it impairs my ability to plan. Reasoning, problem solving, all of those things can be affected. Okay. All right. So again, so it doesn't affect a specific learning type, but of course this affects all learning. It's very conditional. So there are times in which I can read really well, and there's a lot of times in which I cannot read really well, okay? And so it is not legally considered a disability in schools, which is an important distinction, particularly for those K through 12, because of the what that gives them in terms of their rights and accommodations and what they can ask for. Okay, so the superpowers of ADHD. So I just explained all the bad things of ADHD, but they're not bad things, right? They're just differences. And so you can leverage differences, right? That's why I wanna have this conversation is to make sure everyone realizes that and thinks about that a little more. So I can thrive in crisis. So I wait until the last year. I intentionally procrastinate. I'm more creative. Studies have shown that those with ADHD are indeed more creative. I'm intuitive. I don't have a filter of information, which is annoying, but it allows me to develop this intuition that not a lot of other people have. So I can make these other connections because I've pulled in this other information and I haven't necessarily just focused on what I'm being told, right? I'm very impulsive, which is great for engineering, right? So I take a lot of risks. I am not afraid of failure. I always think I can change the world. Deep down inside, I know, okay, maybe that's not true, but I always act accordingly, like I can change the world. We need risk takers in engineering, and we need them now. Because we're all taking the same approach and trying to solve these problems, but we need different approaches. Hyperfocus. This presentation, I'll tell you, I could have worked on this presentation 24 hours, and I almost did. If it wasn't for my wife calling me, my wife balances me. You have to realize that. So hyperfocus is a very powerful thing. You get in the zone. That's what they call it, right? And I can work like nobody else. And I'm very high energy, if you don't know that. Okay, so there are advantages to learning disabilities as well. Because again, it's a different way of thinking, right? It's a different way of approaching problems. So there's this book called The Dyslexic Advantage, and they go through the different, the case really for the strengths of those with dyslexia and why we need people who think like that. The ability to really do long range connections, connect engineering with the arts, things like that. Usually they're very, very good storytellers for that reason, because they can make these long range connections. So there's advantages for those with learning disability and ADHD all around. And so it's not surprising then that this shows up in everywhere, right? Pop culture, Anderson Cooper, those in film. We also have entrepreneurs, those who are not afraid to take risks, right? Do some crazy stuff. They have their hands in everything. They have interests everywhere, very eclectic. The people who take the biggest risks are the people who take the biggest leaps. I feel like in school, we forget that a lot of these people didn't do so well in school, but they didn't do it the same way everyone else did it. One of the things I'm trying to highlight today. And so there is very little talk about this in higher education, about ADHD, about learning differences. I went to the American Society for Engineering Education, ASW, a couple years ago. Thousands of people there. Hundreds, if not a thousand posters. I could not find a single poster that talked about ADHD or disabilities. There was everything. There was plenty of disabilities, physical disabilities, PTSD, everything. Nothing about learning disabilities. And yet, these are some of our strongest students. Some of you in here, I know, some of my best students, right? And we're not talking about this. So Holly White, she's in the University of Michigan in psychology. She is doing a lot of research on those with ADHD and their creativity. Dr. Arash Zaghi, he has written a book called ADHD, the College Experience. He is in civil engineering at, I think UConn, University of Connecticut. I actually called this guy up. I was like, we gotta meet. We gotta collaborate. He told me no. It was actually very interesting. What he told me was, I don't want to, because I want you to start somewhere new, right? I want us to independently build this up. And maybe if we connect later down the road, okay. But right now we shouldn't be thinking in the same way. We need to be thinking different, which I thought was really interesting. Very wise. Okay. So great. So there's a lot of strengths too, but in schools, the 1 in 5 are struggling. So only 21% attend a four-year college, which is about half that of the general population. Only 41% complete college, which is lower than the general population, is about 52%. Something interesting that I've noticed with this, though, is you can see that the discrepancy is not as much in college completion. My hypothesis for that is those with learning disabilities and ADHD who do make it to college have figured something out, right? Or have, high enough intelligence to get them through. And so that's why I really think it's important that we, give some energy to our students with learning disabilities and ADHD, especially, so not just those in college, but those in engineering. Because if you have a learning disability or ADHD in engineering, definitely have something figured out, and you're very, very bright. And I think we need to highlight those students and make sure that they know that they're bright. As I go through today, usually you just get reminded, you know, that you're not as good. Okay. Only 1 in 4 disclose their learning disability. And so that is because of shame. So there's a lot of shame surrounding this. There's a lot of stigma, and that needs to change. 33% of educators think it's just laziness. Some parents think that about their kids, which is really sad. Well, and 43% say that they wouldn't want to. Right? It's hard when you don't have support. So now this is representation. So this is, I think, 2012. Percentage of students with disabilities. So this also includes those with physical disabilities, but also learning disabilities and ADHD. And you can see by the time you get to the doctoral level, they're severely underrepresented. So the goals of this workshop, really, I want to start the discussion. We need to talk about it. We need to erase this stigma. I want to be very transparent. I have learned in my first year of teaching that one of the biggest issues is this wall between students and faculty. And when faculty don't talk to students or aren't transparent about what they're doing, what's going on, why they're doing what they're doing, students will make assumptions about faculty, right? They don't care about teaching. They'd rather be doing research. But then it goes the other way around. If students don't tell the faculty, then the faculty just think they're lazy. They don't care, right? They're just doing this so they can get a job and make money. They don't actually want to learn, right? All kinds of things, right? Or they don't like me, whatever, right? And so I think being transparent, I think, really helps us be efficient and actually make the learning environment effective. And lastly, I want to emphasize metacognition. And so that's kind of where I'm going to take you through in terms of my life and my journey, and how that manifested and how it got me where I am today. Okay, so my physical journey. So I'm from Chicago area. I did my bachelor's in mechanical engineering at Bradley University. You guys probably not familiar, it's in Peoria, Illinois. It's a couple hours west of University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. I then did my PhD in bioengineering at Georgia Tech, and then I did my postdoc at the University of Florida in Gainesville for a couple of years, and I just started as a teaching faculty here at FAMU-FSU a little over a year ago. It's been wonderful. So a little bit about me. So I've already kind of told you a little bit, but I'm very high energy, right? So things I'm very good at, I am good at putting a lot of focus in things I'm very interested in. I'm very good at, I had a list of things and I don't have a cheat sheet. I'm good at things, trust me. I'm very good at building things. I have a great sense of empathy and high emotional intelligence. So I'm very able to very much relate with people, understand where they're coming from. I'm very creative. I talk about things. And of course, the things I'm not good at, and I mentioned that. And this is prevalent in my whole family. So my whole family is ADHD. Luckily, I'm the only one without depression. So if you have depression and ADHD, that can be, it's a game changer. And so, you know, I've had to watch my family struggle. I was lucky. So that's my brother. 7 years older. He's very smart. He hasn't gone to college yet. but he's in Mensa, and he raised me. This is my wife, my beautiful wife, and she's been a wonderful support in addition to my brother and my mother. So anyway, my brother shared with me this poem. I thought this poem was great. I think what's great about this poem is that everyone can relate with it to some degree. Maybe some of you have heard this, but it's worth reading out loud. So it's autobiography in 5 short chapters. Chapter 1, I walk down the street. There is a deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I am lost. I am helpless. It isn't my fault. It takes me forever to find the way out. Chapter 2, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I pretend I don't see it. I fall in again. I can't believe I'm in the same place. But it isn't my fault. It still takes me a long time to get out. Chapter 3, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I see it is there. I still fall in. It's a habit. My eyes are open. I know where I am. It is my fault. I get out immediately. Chapter 4, I walk down the same street. There's a deep hole in the sidewalk. I walk around it. Chapter 5, I walk down another street. So at some point, you got to realize that you can do things differently, right? If what you're doing now isn't working, no matter how small it is, right? It doesn't have to be anything big, but maybe you can't remember to submit homework on campus, or you're just having trouble getting up. If what you're doing is not working, do something different, right? But it takes, you have to be proactive about reflecting on your day-to-day life, right? What works, what doesn't, why these things work, why these things don't work. That's what metacognition is all about. It's an awareness of one's own thought processes and an understanding of the patterns behind them. So metacognition is very focused on how you think, and I think in general, self-awareness really is the key to success. It's the only way you can avoid the holes, right? Is knowing how you fell into them, how you got there. And then you can figure out a way and design a plan to not fall into them, right? And succeed. Because everyone's holes look different, right? Everyone falls in them differently, and they're in different places, and they show up at different times. And so if it was the same for everybody, then there would just be a book on how to avoid holes. But there isn't. So it really is up to you to think about these things and challenge yourself to find a different way, right? Okay, so here is my journey. So I'm gonna zip through K through 12. There's a couple of stops along the way. So first grade, I noticed that I really liked rearranging my room, moving my dresser, moving my bed to a different corner, and then I would organize everything and clean up. And what I found, sometimes I would make these like bullet points, right? A little bed sheet canopy going on. What I found, and I didn't know this at the time, it wasn't until, you know, maybe a few weeks ago when I started making it, that the reason I did that was because I slept better, but only for a few days. And then I would do it again. And then I slept better, right? What I learned was that I needed stimulation to be calm. I needed something to change around me for me to relax, which is really weird and not But part of the reason I realized that was because I do find that I sleep better at like other people's houses because it's a new environment, it's very stimulating, but I sleep better than I have in months. So very interesting is that I'm better with different. An important lesson in third grade, you start getting a lot more books you have to use for your assignments, you have to read. And I kept forgetting my books at home. And so of course my teacher caught on that this is something that I do routinely. And so she told me, she's like, Scott, you know what I do? I take my books and I put them in front of the door to my bed so that to forget them, I have to trip over. And so I literally started doing that, right? And it helped and it worked. But there was a more important realization at this point, right? It was that there are things I can do to avoid falling into holes, right? I have control over how I perform in life and my ability to fulfill my obligation. And so then I started thinking of other ways and other things that I could do in order to stop forgetting things and losing things. My parents told me they would stop buying me new hats, new jackets, because I lost tens of them. So that was a really important lesson. Fourth to sixth grade, you know, once you get into junior high, things, or middle school, things start getting complicated, hormones start spiking and things. So fourth to sixth grade, I started acting out a bit. I even bullied a student or two. I would do some weird things. This is really embarrassing. But keep in mind, I was in fourth grade. But we would get a substitute teacher, and I would stand up in front of the class, and I would just say, Mrs. Brady, I feel like a butt. I don't know what that means. I don't know why I said it. But I did things like that. Of course, the whole class laughs, right? And that was my goal. But what I realized was that I would do these things in order to decouple my academic performance and my social status, right? So the kid who stands up and says, I feel like a butt, of course he would not do so well on the exam or the test. Right? Of course he would forget his homework or didn't do his homework, right? So I was lowering expectations and I stopped disappointing other people. I stopped disappointing myself. It was a brilliant strategy. I did not consciously do that. I didn't realize that's what I was doing, again, until I started, I wrote my personal statement for my NSFS. In fact, I encourage a lot of students just to go through the process because when you write a personal statement, it forces you to kind of reflect on your life. I think some of those, you know, realizations are really important and very important. This is a four-barrel spitball gun. So I was an engineer early on. I used bending straws, of course, so I could kind of like a Gatling gun. This is a replica of the actual gun confiscated from my law. I also listened to a lot of metal, different music. I love Rammstein. I still love Rammstein. That is something my brother and I bond on. It's not everyone's cup of tea. But it kind of reinforced to me that I was different and that I could be compared. So everyone who tried to compare me, you know, I would remind myself of music that I could be compared, right? Anything really to keep myself esteem afloat. So right before high school, I took something called the ISACS, the Illinois State Achievement Test. State exam. I got, you know, 99th percentile in math, reading. I couldn't tell you. But they kicked me out of honors, literature, and everything like that. And I was devastated. To take a step backwards, you know, all of my friends are in these honors classes, right? All the smartest people that I know, and I wasn't going to be in a class with them. And in high school, like, you know, that's devastating, especially when you're first going to start because you're a freshman, you know, you're going to get bullied, and you're going to see your friends, and, well, I'm not going to see my friends. But not only that, apparently I'm dumber, right? Wasn't all that bad, actually. It turned out okay. So instead of honors lit, I got put in this combined world studies class. It combines literature with history. And they really take a novel approach to it, and it's very project-oriented. So this is where I learned that I really like projects. So we had this project. It's called the Monument Project. We were to invent a new national monument. A monument for something there was no monument for, okay? We had to build our monument, which got me excited. But the model must not be larger than a shoebox. And if it is larger than a shoebox, you get a note. We had this teacher, she's very strict, very, very tiny, just she was dead serious. She would flog you if you brought something like a shoebox. So it's okay. So you know, a bunch of students bring in these monuments, these projects, and shoeboxes. These are obviously not real because these all are monuments that actually exist. This is where I started. So a large slab of plywood. And it's funny, I didn't notice in this picture, but there is actually a shoebox here. It goes just to hold the tools. So I got a bunch of foam. I went to the, you know, like three different hobby stores. I spray painted wood with this like granite spray paint stuff and used plaster and stones I found outside and twigs. I used a mesh with clay, spray painted that. I got a G.I. Joe, spray painted that. The American flag, I feel like I didn't put a whole lot of effort in that. You know, that is very common for those with ADHD. Very, very excited, put a whole lot of energy into a project. 98% of the way there. The last 2%, you lost interest. That is losing interest. Oh, gosh. There's another shoebox in this picture. It also lit up. I had LEDs. So what I did was I took a bunch of paint sticks and I propped them all the way around and I put a bed sheet over it. And I don't know where. So when we had to unveil it, then myself and a friend, we carried this thing into the class, right? All the other shoeboxes are all along the side of the classroom. And she sees me bring this dish. Her head. She knew she had a point. So I unveiled it. It was a monument to Pointe du Hoc, by the way, the rangers that went up the cliffs of Normandy in World War II. I got an A plus. Highest grade. So in high school, I kept myself busy. I got a job. The day I turned 15, the day I could get a worker's permit, I worked at Culver's. Any Culver's fans here? Yeah. All right. They just built a Culver's in Tallahassee about 6 months ago. I've already been there like 30 times. I worked there for 4 years, and I got promoted to assistant manager when I was 17. Loved that job. I worked a lot of hours. I played a lot of basketball. At one point I was playing three leagues at once. I played a lot of frisbee and I started focusing more on math and science. So I got injured in basketball and I started kind of shifting my focus to math and science. I used the money made from Culver's and spent like $3,000 on the laptop. Because I started to realize that I really needed to work harder than other people to succeed. There was a standard and expectation for me to have straight A's when I was going to apply to college, to get fives on all the AP exams, you know, and everything like that. So I put a lot of money, I put a lot of time, put a lot of effort into meeting those expectations. And I did. I had straight A's last 2 years, and I got fives on all my AP exams. But I did everything. Back then, it was iTunes U. And MIT was like one of the only universities that had their course videos in there. So I watched all those physics courses and everything. I'm pretty proud of what I achieved, just through brute force, like working really hard. So then I went to college. You know, one thing I did in applying to college, I applied to two colleges. One, the local community college, which I knew I would get, and two, Bradley University. All of my friends in engineering went to the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, and because it is an amazing school in engineering, it's closer to home than Bradley by a little bit, and I couldn't get myself to apply. Did I think I was going to get in? I don't know. I think it doesn't matter. I think for me, it was, I didn't want to be compared to my peers. I wanted to go somewhere where I knew I wanted a blank slate, and I wanted to be able to have a little more freedom and be a little more relaxed and do and perform however I'll perform, because that was an uncertainty. College, there's a lot going on. There's a lot of freedom. There's a lot of things to do. Meeting a lot of new people. There's always people in the hallway for some reason, which is really annoying. It was hard. A lot of distractions, very difficult focusing, a lot of competing interests and pressure from peers. So I was very good at Frisbee. No one could outjump me. And at some point in the semester, things got really, really tough, particularly in chemistry. So chemistry was boring. It was simple math. It was a lot of memorization. It just did not stimulate me. I did terrible. And I know I didn't want to put any time into it. First exam, I got a D. And coming from straight A's, right, this is alarming, right? And of course, I have a minimum GPA to maintain a scholarship. And so I tell the Frisbee guys, I said, hey, I got to really focus on chemistry, right? And they're not happy. I keep getting all these like texts, you know, assume, you know, where are you? Why are you talking to the tournament? Things like that, right? It's hard. It's hard to maintain friendships when you have to do things different, when you have to do things that people don't understand why. Those with ADHD and their disabilities in general have a harder time maintaining. So I tried different things, you know, going to the library, finding the most isolated spot that's dark and old books, nothing that could distract me, right? Yeah, a little better, but I wound up with a C. It's my first C ever, and it dragged my GPA down to 3. I mean, it was my first semester, it was my first college GPA, right? But that was minimum for my scholarship. So that was very concerning. I also had a 97% going into the final calculus 3, and I got a B. I asked the professor, he's like, you bombed it. And that professor recommended that the tutoring center hired me to be a math tutor. And I went there and they're like, yeah, I don't know, your professor just told us to hire you. I don't know what, actually he just contacted me a few months ago. Anyway, it's nice when you have somebody recognize that there is something special about you. So end of the semester, I was obviously not happy. My mom drove 2.5 hours, picked me up, It was cold Chicago day. And I just kind of leaned against the window, right? Pressed my face against it. And just thought about me, reflected, right? Apparently, when I was gone, you're gone for one semester and everything changes. They just built a Panda Express next to my house. I love Panda Express. I love orange chicken. So she's like, why don't we go to this Panda Express? Okay, that sounds good. At least at the time, they would give you this mound of orange chicken, right, on a plate on top of rice. So I got this mound of orange chicken, my favorite. And I couldn't eat it. You know, I had too much on my mind. Obviously, my mom saw that. So, this is one of those. She looked me in the eyes, and I know myself well enough. I know I can't say what she said. So, but this is what she said. And I just started crying. You know, to have someone understand what you did when there is no one else who does, right? Everyone, in fact, everyone thinks it's your fault. Everyone thinks it's because you're lazy, you're not smart, right? No one gets it. But my mom, she gets it. It's okay. So, semester two. I am the type of person that bounces back 10 times harder. And so I was not going to fail. Unfortunately, in engineering, no, the second semester of chemistry. So this is the lecture hall where I took chemistry. I took the first exam. And I got the D. Differential equations exam, I got a D. It didn't matter how hard I tried. I said, enough is enough. I'm going to get diagnosed. So I had not been diagnosed up to this point. We had suspected, I mean, it's genetic, everyone else in my family has it, you know, but I've done pretty well to this point. So I said, that's it. I'm going to get medicated. You know, that's it. So I scheduled an appointment. It wound up being early in the morning during chemistry lecture. So I emailed my professor and said, hey, you know, I have this doctor's appointment I'm going to go to and everything, so I'll be late to class. So I had the appointment, got diagnosed, got a prescription, and I rushed back for like the last 5-10 minutes of class. Right at the top of the stairs here, I ran into my professor. Everyone, you know, I'm trying to get through as everyone's coming out. And he's handing them something or something. I don't know. And I was like, oh, crap. Like, what did I miss? Right. And I asked him, I said, what did I miss? And he said, you should try showing up to class. And then, it shocked me. I didn't know what to say. I went back to my dorm and I just sat on the IKEA futon and I just thought about it. I didn't know. I sat there for about half an hour and then I said, he's got to know. I got to go tell him. So I went. I didn't know if he was going to be there or answer it. So I go to his office, knock on the door, and he's there. He'll, I said, do you mind if I close the door? I just started crying. I haven't had any of you cry in my office yet, but I can imagine it was uncomfortable for him, as it was for me. Obviously, very embarrassed. And I told him, I laid it out for him, right? He needed to know. He needed to know that he misjudged me. He got it wrong. And then I told him, I had emailed him. So I told him. And so he didn't know what to do, right? He's very awkward about it. And so he thought that he could look at my grade and give me some good news. So he looks at my grade. There's no good news there, right? So he looks at the grade and he said, you know, Like, I don't know if there's any coming back from it. The next exam is the hardest exam of the semester. Another one of my strengths, though, of grouping people well. It's one of the things that really motivates me. So I took the exam. Of course, I studied, right? I was on medication. I studied a lot, right? And medication really, really helped. So, okay, so it's the day, we get back the, that's where I got diagnosed. That's where I took the medication. I forgot about that, sorry. Okay, well, we went over that. Anyway, I got medicated. I come back here, right? I sit down, and they start handing back the exams, the TAs or whatever. Okay, everyone's got the exams all flipping through all the pages, right? So I was sitting like over here somewhere. My professor, he starts walking up these desks. You know, putting his foot on the seats, walking up, climbing up and up. He takes my exam, flips it over to the back, looks at the score, puts it down, looks at me, and then walks back. So I got a 94, one of the highest grades in the class. That was his score. So at this point, after the semester, I got like a 3.8 or something, you know, saved my scholarship. I realized I am not going to go through college the same way that everyone else goes through. It's just not going to happen. I can't do it like everyone else. I got to do something different. This is where you leverage metacognition. This is where you leverage knowing how you think, knowing how you work, knowing what works and what does not. And having the guts to ignore all the other advice you get, like don't procrastinate. So that summer, I taught myself SolidWorks. I taught myself action script programming, which is Flash animation. I made my own website. I made my own business card. I got a LinkedIn account. At that time, nobody had a LinkedIn account. I started projects up again. I was trying to make this robotic ball bot. I got a suit. So my nickname was Thor. Thor says, I got a suit, right? I was ready to go into that first fall job fair and get an internship because I knew that I could sell myself this way. Get the internship, get your foot in the door, and I'd have the job, right? And then school, maybe I would be a little more relaxed. It wouldn't matter as much. That was my plan. I got really lucky because I didn't get any internships. I had an interview because I knew the janitor at one place. They didn't hire me. I got a co-op. Nobody wanted to do co-ops because co-ops you have to take off. Right? I got this co-op at an aerospace company called Hamilton Sunstrand. Never heard of it. It turns out Hamilton Sunstrand has the largest contribution to the most innovative aircraft at the time, the Boeing 787. They had the entire electrical system, nitrogen generation system, actuation system, everything. Actually, Boeing never allowed a supplier to have that much competition for a plane ever again because it was like a decade late, and of course, they blamed us. Long story. Anyway, this co-op was awesome. I got paid a lot of money. They let me do whatever I wanted because they realized this guy is just going to find problems and solve it for us. We didn't even know we had. I'd love to talk more about this. I wound up emailing the president and said, I want to do more. He delivered on that, by the way. It was wonderful. I feel like I don't have time for all that. It turned out really well. By the end of it, the director of engineering told the co-op coordinator, we have to hire this. And I was like, well, Yeah, wait, like 2 and a half. But I will say they did offer me about 2 matches. They did. I thought they forgot, to be honest. But anyway, I came back a whole new person. I did all of these projects, so I was very relaxed at this point because I thought, you know, what do I need the good grades for? I've got everything I need. So I taught myself how to make circuit boards. I bought a $5,000 milling machine. I threw it in my mom's one car garage. So it became a no car garage. And I made my own taillights and I programmed them to be animated. It was wonderful. And this really just kept me stimulated, it kept me going. And it let me do better in classes. I did school better this way, right? It was a transformation. This is my undergraduate research mentor. He came out on the quad as I was playing frisbee. He said, "You should do research for me." I go in his office. We start talking about it. I don't remember saying this, but he keeps telling me this. He keeps reminding me. Apparently, I told him or asked him. I said, "Couldn't you find anyone smarter?" Anyway, I want to gain a first author publication out of that, and that's what got me into Georgia Tech. I could do 2 presentations in grad school. That was a life-changing experience. But I graduated, and I had a group make me this cart that they pull me around in. I don't know if you recognize this. Does anyone play Rocket League? People don't want to admit it. Thank you, Rory. So I played a lot of Rocket League to de-stress in grad school, and my favorite car was Sweet Tooth from Twisted Metal. So they built me a replica with the clown on top and pulled me around that right in front of me. And then did my postdoc at the University of Florida. Here, I really started focusing on mentoring undergrads. I mentored undergrads to do my postdoc research for me. I recruited 3 freshmen. All 3 went to BMES as sophomores. It was really where I found my kind of my calling, you know, that being a mentor, helping others develop themselves, grow, learn how to do research, really get that snowball of success started. So now I'm teaching faculty here. I guess this presentation was about how I got here, but you know, I keep thinking random days, you know, I don't know how I got. But I do. It was metacognition, and it was my support system, all the people that were rooting for me. So summarize, here's the takeaways. You're not alone. Professors are people too. Professors have struggled before. And I can't learn so well either. But I found ways. Another takeaway is we need more people with learning disabilities, ADHD, and engineering. And nobody else is saying that, and I don't know why. Because that could save the world. We don't know. But it could. I mean, we need people who think differently in engineering, have a support system, have advocates, have allies, have people that will support you, people that understand you, people that know you. They can advocate for you when you can, right? You're going to be in positions where you really have no power, no say, and you need someone to act on your behalf. That's very, very important. Metacognition is extremely powerful. Knowing yourself, knowing what conditions in which you will thrive, right? Because if you know yourself well enough, you will have the confidence to ignore conventional wisdom and advice, such as procrastination is bad, or find a system to stay organized and stick with it. You know what I found? You know, I rearrange my bed every week or so, right? So I sleep there. I change my organization strategy weekly. Sometimes it's a piece of paper. Sometimes it's post-it. Sometimes it's my phone. Sometimes it's a Word document. Sometimes it's Outlook. It changes every time. That keeps me organized. Changing it keeps me stimulated. Otherwise, it becomes white belt. Know yourself and lean into yourself. Embrace your differences. Right? Don't try to fight that. Don't try to work against the grain. Figure out how you best learn and do that. And bring different to the table. So I just want to thank, you know, my family, friends and mentors, and my brother. Thanks. Happy to answer any questions if anyone has any. Yes.
So you said earlier, I struggle with this sometimes too, that intuition, where you just like, I guess because a lot of stimuli that comes in, like, just know. How do you overcome that? Like, people are like asking, like, what is this? And then I have a lot of trouble explaining how I know this. And I know it's right, but then, like, you know, like, especially if you know an exam and stuff, it's like, well, explain the reason behind it. It's like,
yeah, I mean, you can't, and I can't say I've done a good job at holding my ground. I usually let it go. How can you convince someone of that, right? I think if we bring awareness to it, and the fact that this is a strength of those with learning differences, that maybe then others will be able to trust that, but I think for now, I don't know if I can tell you. It's a challenge for sure. Yes.
So you say you're a risk taker?
Yes.
So for like people who struggle taking trips, you're failing at construction, expectations are being at your best all the time.
Mm-hmm.
What is something that
That's hard. It is my personality to take risks, prove people wrong. You know, for someone who's trying to take more risks, I would say start with low risk, right? Low risk, low reward. Don't try to save the world. Start there. Something else I would say is expect failure. I think, and I always tell students of this in grad school, that grad school is miserable. If you go to grad school and you didn't know it was going to be miserable and then you find out it is, it's miserable. If you go to grad school, someone told you it was going to be miserable and it's miserable, yeah, okay, they were right. Right? It's expected. Feels like you're still in control of your life. I would say that for risk taking. Expect that failure. So when it happens, you still feel like you have control and you haven't lost it. It's the best advice I can give. Yes?
Oh, okay. I was gonna say, speaking of grad school, would you say that your ADHD like helped you or hindered you?
Helped.
Was it a mixed bag?
Yes, I wish I could have skipped college and went straight to grad school. I mean, grad school, you have to learn so many different things. You have to learn how to read, how to write, how to do experiments, how to analyze the experiments, how to make figures, how to give presentations, how to do qualifying exams, all sorts of things. It is so stimulating. I feel like I'm always growing. That's the environment that I needed to learn with, to learn in it. So definitely, that's a good question. I didn't even tell you to set me up like that. Yes.
I have like a complete opposite question that she had. I think that I like take this just to be different.
Yes.
you know,
for stimulation.
Yeah, just because like yes. But I was wondering like how you have decided when risks are not worth taking, because I feel like doing like your, you know, like an analysis, a risk assessment every time, like I guess, and so just like develop a feeling for it.
Yes. I think that's a really great question. Over time, I think you have a better sense of what is worth it. I think you have a better sense of what your values are and what is worth taking a risk for, and what risks maybe where the reward is really not worth the potential for failure. Well, and not necessarily even failure, because maybe that's not something we're afraid of, but wasting the time taking the risk is something usually I'm afraid of.
So you just evaluate the reward against what area.
Yeah, I mean, but over time, it's like I developed an intuition for that. And I mean, that was just something I had to learn. Yeah, I think it's more of an intuitive thing. I don't think I really had a conscious discussion with myself.
Rupert. Do you have any tips for maintaining discipline? Because I feel like, you know, I heard you mention it a few times, like proving people wrong, and it's like, that's satisfying. That's very fading feeling, you know, because it comes and goes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like your chemistry teacher walks all the way up, you get like that one moment of like, haha, like the 94, and then like it's gone.
Yes.
Like, mm-hmm. I feel like it's one of those things where it's very self-oriented, like to maintain discipline. So I was like wondering if you had any tips on that, like how you find it to be like, I should do this now because I'll thank myself later.
Yeah. You have to get creative. In fact, sometimes it's just a way of framing the task in your mind. For this presentation, even, it's hard because I somewhat had something together. It was not really good. And so to get myself back into that and working in it is like hard. But what I did was like I led myself to believe that there was going to be like 100 people, right? And I knew deep down inside, okay, it's probably not true. But I don't know, I convinced myself, and then it really like motivated me just to make sure that this was going to be the best it was going to be. Other times you can make things games. Other times you can convince yourself that you're doing something that no one else is doing. And maybe you're trying to head something off and you convince yourself that no one else is doing that and you're going to be ahead of the game. It can be a little dangerous because you can kind of feel like maybe you're better than other people. But as long as you can control that and maintain your integrity in that aspect, I don't think it's harmful to kind of frame things in that way in order to kind of keep yourself motivated. Does that make sense?
No, I get it.
Yeah. Good question. And of course, then small things like music. You know, I find that I really like high energy music, which is why I have the list of questions on there. I said, what is your favorite music? And I say, avoid maybe answering in terms of a genre. Because I think everybody kind of resonates with certain types of music. It's not necessarily a genre, right? But music can kind of take you motivated to do anything. It's just a matter of what you set your sights on. So. There's a lot of things. Yes.
I guess my question is kind of like his. But you did a lot of really incredible projects that you finished and like came to fruition, are very impressive, and you taught yourself so many things. But you're saying really like you do things like 90% of the way, or even like in my case, I'll get really excited about something, like start it for like a week and then give up or stop or move on. So I'm just wondering, like, how were you able to like finish things like this?
Great question. The only finished thing I showed you was those fail heads.
Okay, but you also like taught yourself SOLIDWORKS and codes and how to start it. Like you like finished a lot of things like in doing that.
Yeah, you know, so like that ball bot that never got finished. Like and there was probably 15 other projects I started that never finished. But I will say with that, those taillights, I don't know what it is. It was like I had to prove to myself that I could finish a project. And I finished that one project. And when I did, I said, no more projects. I don't know what it was, but honestly, that was the only thing I truly finished that in terms of a project that I've done on my own. Because I don't know how to get that last 2% done otherwise. I wish I had better advice for you there.
Okay, then maybe I'm wondering, how are you able to teach yourself things well enough to put it on a resume to apply? Because that's also a project in its own.
I also have a follow-up question about how did you manage all of those projects and teaching yourself all of those things like while you were doing school?
I think it made me more efficient. So I had a lot of labs at that time, fluid lab, thermal lab. I didn't get A's on them, but I didn't get C's. I was really, really efficient because I was freaking out and I really wanted to spend time on these other things. And so I found a way to put just the minimal effort there. I think if you start too soon, it depends if you also have anxiety and other things, but for me, starting too soon is like a death sentence because I'm just too relaxed, right? I take my time and I'm like, oh, like there's no pressure. Like I can think about this differently. I can take a second to think. Very inefficient, very easy to get distracted. Where's it going to that? Oh, so I think having this other project actually helped me be more efficient and do only kind of the bare minimum that I needed to do. So I think that's the only way I could pull it off.
Did it kind of give you a reward? So if you did your studying, you could reward yourself with this thing that was really exciting and interesting?
I mean, I wish I could say I had that much control and discipline. No. I did what I don't even know this, right? I mean, I did what I went with the flow. I went with the flow.
But you were not medicating then, or you were?
I was. I learned that on medication, you have to be very careful about how you start your day, what you start working on. Because once you start, you're not gonna do anything else. As they say, let's see, off medication, I'm a terrific multitasker, can't focus. On medication, I can hyper-focus if can't focus. But I think I was able to, I honestly think I neglected school until I got that project. Once I got it done, it was so relieving, I can't explain it to you. It was something I needed to get done. That was fine. I turned out. Yes.
So with the metacognition and the self-reflection, like I totally understand how that helped you, but would you say that there was ever a point where it like kind of steps into rumination a little bit, like negatively affects you? Or is it like, do you kind of like separate yourself?
Yeah, I mean, look, you can't have regrets, right? There's nothing you can change about the past. And everything you did for some reason, right? I mean, we look at some of these things that maybe we consider really bad choices. But you have to consider what you were feeling, what your mindset was, what was going on in your life at that time. I mean, you're human. Like, you've got to cut yourself some slack. But at the same time, like, be honest with yourself. So I think that's how I frame it in my head when I look at those kind of more negative things, is I'm being honest with myself. And don't blame yourself, right? Like when I say I was bullying a kid, I mean, like, there was a kid who was hard of hearing, right? And I was doing things like whispering with a friend, right? That we knew what we were saying, but he couldn't hear us. I mean, these very mean things. But you know, I was a kid. I apologize at some point. Good question. That's a good question. Oh, yes. Say, well, Bailey, do you mind? Do you have any questions?
So like when you're in that hyper focus mode, you don't really want to stop doing the productive thing that you're doing, because then you don't know if you're ever going to stop. I forget, like eat, sleep. Like, how have you dealt with that? Like, you try to take care of yourself in between the hyper focus.
Yes, good question. So one, the Apple Watch helps me. It does remind me to take a breather, to stand up. That actually works. Sometimes I will get like water, put it like right in front, you know, or I'll tell myself every time this happens, I'm gonna like get up and do this or something like that, right? And I always make sure that I have snacks nearby, because I think that one of the reasons I don't eat or forget to eat is because I'm afraid if I peel away, I'm never going to get that, right? So if it's right there, I know I can at least take a bite and you know, don't miss a beat, right? That's a good question. Nicole?
Yeah, I was
going to
ask, like,
when you're
talking, like, you know, like,
that's a really good and thoughtful question. It's hard. First off, you have to know you can only do so much. People have to get themselves out, you know. But I think one thing is you have to let people know it's okay. It's okay to have these problems. Everybody has these problems or challenges. It's okay to see a therapist. It's okay to get diagnosed. People need to just know that it's okay. And I think that that's probably the best thing that you could do. But also reaching out every so often and just understand that they probably are not going to reach out to you, and it's not because they don't consider you a good friend, and it's not because you're never on their mind. It's just the way that they're trying to survive. When I went to college, I talked to my mom once a month. It's unfortunate because of how much she means to me, but she gets it, right? So I think that's the best support. Oh, yes.
Okay, so have you always overloaded your schedule? And do you have any advice on how not to do that?
Because, not to overload your schedule?
Yeah, because you were talking about how in high school you kept yourself extremely busy, and it sounds like in undergrad and graduate school, you also kept yourself extremely busy just finding everything to fill your time.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering, have you always done that? And like, have you figured out how to limit that? So, you know, good time for sleep and social.
Good question. And I have always done that. I think what I started doing is building in more things that pertain to my core values and things that like I need to maintain, like hygiene and exercise. And so I was always busy all the time. So I haven't tried not being busy. Yes.
Well, how do you, so like in a marriage, there's like this contract that you're going to like be there. Like, I mean, because I have a child with ADHD and I have ADHD.
Yeah.
And we, it is crazy balls all the time. And, you know, like for your wife, like if it's important to her that you do something, I think this kind of goes to what you're talking about. Like if you're overscheduled, my daughter and I will just, constant stimulation or no stimulation. You know, there's other people in our family that want to do things, and it's very hard. Like, how do you make sure you're doing what your wife would like?
Mm-hmm.
How do you do that? And
mm-hmm.
Some people, I think, block it out in their calendar. That works for me for one day, and then the next day, I'm like, well, that's what was yesterday, so that's not going to be my weekend. No, I just ignore it.
Okay, I'm glad you framed it like that because now I feel like maybe I have an answer. So what I did with my wife, so this first year was rough, right? So I was working pretty much 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, every day. Recently, I'm trying to pull back. So Saturdays, I say at noon, but no. And that winds up working really well because then I get up earlier, like 4:30, and I will work until noon. And when I approach that deadline, I'm at my best, right? Because I'm right near a deadline. And so I'm more efficient and work better than if I was just going to work till 7. Yeah. So I'll do that. I also frame it in terms of, you know, it could be simple things like my wife wants me to like wash the dishes, right? And things like that, right? I will frame it in a way that it appears to me that she's in crisis, which may not be true. But when I do that, I really rise to the occasion and I step in. So again, it's kind of just like an altered way of framing it in my head just to get myself to do it. I lead myself to believe I'm on some sort of condition, right? And it works. Did that, Micah?
No, I was just thinking about how I would respond to this time.
Oh.
They don't tell you what to do, they just make you feel real guilty.
Yes. but I always side with her. I always blame myself. Any other, yes?
Okay, this is like a simple question, but do you feel like you have issues like completing homework assignments when you're in school?
Yes.
Well, and like, were you able to turn in any complete homework assignment, like completely feel okay about it?
I think that's a good question. I think to some degree, I got it to a point where I thought it was complete, or I convinced myself so, when maybe it just wasn't really. Like, at least I've attempted every single problem. And I think that helps me sleep at night. So, if you honestly don't have the time, if I honestly didn't have the time to do it, I think that's what I would do, is just, like, at least put something down for every problem. And then in my head, I convince myself that I've actually attempted every problem. That's usually not reality, right? But, yes?
How do you feel like do you ever come to this point where like it had to be perfect or like all or nothing kind of thing?
Yes, all the time. That happens more so on medication now. I don't want to deal with that. Again, it's one of those things that I don't deal with. Sometimes I just wait longer before I start. Sometimes it's the right way, so that I don't spend that much time. I know, maybe these are the most elegant solutions. Question?
Yes. The last part of your summary slide, you're saying like embrace or into your intuition or leading to the things that work best for you. Have you ever tried, suppressed, but not have your personality type, like do certain aspects of your personality type?
Can you ask it again?
So, like,
the last part.
The last part, you're saying, like, your summary, you're saying lean in and embrace your intuition or embrace who you are,
mm-hmm.
or the your quirks.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever choose your quirks or or lower them to accommodate offerings or accommodate social harmoniousness?
Yes. That's a really good question. I always do that at the beginning whenever I'm making first impressions. Because I have to have people's trust. And then I slowly start going back to leaving it.
Has it worked well for you, or you think, or?
I think I sufficiently trick people. I mean that. I mean, what I do is I typically am very quiet. I don't contribute. I don't say anything. I try to keep a low profile. so that nobody notices me. And then, I mean, this is almost a systematic strategy, and the only reason I remember it is because I've recently done it, right? I will keep a low profile, and then I will get allies one at a time. I will latch on to one person. So here it was Dr. Arce. And I got really close with Dr. Arce. You know, I divulged personal details about myself, so he kind of understood me and knew me, knew where I was coming from. And I knew that he would step up for me if ever I needed him to. And then, you know, I got kind of another person, and I kind of do it one at a time. It's overwhelming when it's everyone, and I freeze up. And when I get enough people who I think understand me and know me, I kind of let loose. But that's when I'm at my best. So I'm really like looking forward to that. It's been hard in the pandemic, and I started the faculty in the pandemic. Actually, kind of made it easier, right, to keep a low profile. But it made it hard for me to get that one ally, right? Does that answer your question? Is that what you were? Okay.
Kind of related to that. But I feel like both you and Dr. Arce are very candid people, like with their personalities,
yeah,
very emotionally open and stuff. So has that ever been like a hindrance for you in like an academic career path? Because I feel like a lot of times, like,
has ever backfired?
Yeah. Like, I feel like a lot of times, like, you know, faculty positions and like that sort of like fancy science career path often encourages like professionality 24/7.
Yeah, if it's backfired, I don't know.
Everybody in academia is weird as heck. They aren't professional. That's maybe like some of the weirdest people work here. People like that. But they're like geniuses. Like, I would say academia, so I'm not an academic, but I've worked here. I've worked lots of places, and you can get away with any kind of personality you want in academia. I would say that it's like the opposite. It's like, if that's your thing, then just go for it. Because we're here.
Yeah.
So weird.
So actually, I would say, like, I think maybe sometimes I go a little far in terms of what I do, maybe during. I'm not being crazy, but I think I speak my mind when I feel like I speak my mind. And I think that backfires, and then people sort of listen to me, and so forth. But also, I don't have a terrible amount of experience with that because I usually do people with profiles. So.
Yeah, I have a question for you, which is, I did not know that I had ADHD until I was 28 years old. Until you had to listen to me, and I got tested. We had that long conversation, so it was like 30 minutes, and we were like 3 hours on Zoom, remember?
Well, you got tested.
Combined type. So anyway, what I'm trying to, like, I thought I was just like an extrovert that had no TMI meter that was like, but I see it in my daughter. Like, do you see that as something with ADHD? Like, just this like open book.
Oversharing?
But kind of like this, I don't think of it as that, as more as like, I'm just like honest. Like, you want to know my, right, but I see that as a very good thing.
Yes.
Like, that's what I am attracted to, that with people.
Right.
Almost like a bee to honey.
Yeah.
And I see that my child is too. And I wonder if that is like a thing with ADHD.
It is.
Is it really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Being impulsive, not having a filter. It's a relaxing,
it is relaxing
state of being.
But
right?
People hate it, don't they?
Well, sure.
It's better for you.
It is so much better.
It's better for you as individuals so that we know you put it out there so they won't act like a douchebag, man. You know,
yes.
Kind of feels, that's what I look at.
I think I need to wear a shirt that says, please don't take me the wrong way, like all the time, you know? But is that what you're saying? So your strategy is to just be quiet, because I am not able.
Only at the beginning.
I can't do it.
Only at the beginning.
I cannot.
Because once people at least see what you're capable of, then they at least know you're capable of that, right? And also, I'm finding it really works well with students. I think to me if I'm wrong. There's enough of you to correct me. But I feel like you have a little more respect for me if I'm a little more open with you guys. So, you know, I know. That's how I don't care about the suit.
On that, I would say it's a combination of because there's like it's not just you, it's also like whoever you talk to. Like, it's also people being aware of those type of things, but like being that everybody's got.
That's what I mean in the professional world, like here in faculty meetings and stuff. There's like everybody's weird, but if you say something off the cuff or honest,
yeah, it doesn't apply.
It does not. Like if you say no, I don't agree with that, no. You better find a more words to say that and don't use the word no. It's very weird.
I hope I learned that someday.
Me too. Murray is my direct report. I direct report directly to the dean, and he has said to me so many times, diplomatic.
Oh, really? I can see that. But there's some degree I don't want to learn that,
right?
Yeah.
I have a question that's really different than our talking about. I'm wondering, do you ever not take your medication? And do you have an explanation for why you don't? Because I don't take the medication like all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe because I'm not used to it yet. Because
mm-hmm.
I also got diagnosed on his recommendation. I have no explanation for why I don't take it. I just like, I don't know, I think I like myself better without it.
Yeah, I mean, your personality can be definitely different. I never, part of that, I think, is because I'm so obsessed with understanding how I work. And if I take it, if I'm off of it, I work differently. And so I have to be able to master it myself and know how I work best. That's the only way I'm going to be able to survive. So it's either one or the other for me. The other one's very unpredictable. But sometimes fun with my wife. So. On our honeymoon, I think maybe it didn't take long.
You know, I have a child who's been on it since she's 7. She's now 12. And her psychiatrist explained it to me in this way. She said ADHD medication is very important if you are in a structured educational setting and you need to conform to that set, like college, like K-12 or college. But on the weekends, because my daughter is young enough, she doesn't have stuff to do on weekends really. I don't give it to her. Because she's more creative, she's more free, she eats more, she is more herself. And anytime there's breaks, I don't give it to her. And the psychiatrist is the one that said that. Said it's don't be afraid to not, because it goes out of your system within 24 hours. So it's like if you're going on Christmas break, you don't have to take it. Like it's only there to help you do what this external system says that you need to do, which is focus on this thing right here instead. So it's not a natural state for your brain. No.
Sometimes I will dump some out. Sometimes I'll take a partial. So I'll do that. Any other questions? I hope nobody feels like obligated to say if you have to go, please.
Would it be helpful for there to be like a group or regular sessions like this for people on this campus? This is the first one we've ever done because Dr. Corson offered to do it. But you know, we could do a group or whatever.
Sure.
I could actually order the concept
for real.
And just have a group thing like at night or something if you guys wanted to. And I don't know, most of you are B&B, right? So there might be other people in other departments that don't know that.
Yeah.
It's probably a suggestion to add to, I guess,